And now I'd like to introduce John Miller, who is CNN's chief law enforcement intelligence analyst and former NYPD Deputy Commissioner for Intelligence and Counterterrorism, to introduce my good friend, Pat Brosnan.
Thank you, Steve. And welcome, everyone. Coming through the room, I saw a lot of friends here. But I want to talk about one of them tonight, Pat Brosnan. Can you stay with me in the far end there? There we go. Now, Pat and I share something remarkable in common. We were both born just before dawn at St. Vincent's Hospital in Greenwich Village. And that is where the similarities end. I, of course, returned home, and he returned home, and I went to the mean streets of Sutton Place in the Upper East Side, where I learned to ride my bicycle in the Vest Parkett Parks of the East River and play with the diplomats' children at the UN. Pat went to 138 and Willis Avenue in the South Bronx, where his Coliseum was Yankee Stadium, where the Champs-Élysées was the Grand Concourse, where the Arc de Triomphe was the Bronx County Courthouse. He was destined to be a Bronx guy, and he was. He grew up there. He came onto the NYPD in 1983. Now, a lot of you aren't old enough, but coming onto the NYPD in 1983 was like walking into a hurricane that was just about to happen. By 1985, the crack epidemic had seized the city. By 1990, we had the highest crime in the history of New York City and became the murder capital and the crime capital of the nation. We are far, far from that. And largely because of the work of the Pat Brosnans of the world. But Pat was dedicated to the people he grew up with. He was a cop in the 4-6 precinct. And when he had the chance to go to narcotics and get that detective shield, he stayed in the 4-6 precinct in their narcotics module right there. Never left his own neighborhood. And when he became a detective and left narcotics and went into the detective bureau, he went to the 4-6 precinct robbery investigation team, the RIP unit, because he was all about helping the victims of crime in the Bronx. And those were people who were being robbed, who couldn't afford to be robbed. And Pat was the guy who cared, who took up their cause, and who made a lot of collars and brought them to the Bronx County Courthouse. I came across Pat when I came into the NYPD in 1994, and he had been working for a candidate for mayor. He had been on the volunteer security detail for Rudy Giuliani, and he had a chance, an opportunity, to go from the 46th Precinct robbery investigation team to the Intelligence Bureau and the mayor's security detail, perhaps the most vaunted assignment you could get in the New York City Police Department, the most elite unit. But Pat said, you know, I would really like to stay here catching crooks because they are making victims. And when he retired and brought his parents into his home and built them a wing so that they could live comfortably under, you know, under his wing, under his protection, under him giving back to what he gave them. And I always looked at that. Someone who passed over opportunity, who passed over politicking, who passed on the career he loved to make sure he took care of the people he loved even more. But it was when Pat went into business that there was the seed of this dream. And the dream was about sending a message back to the police of the city of New York. And that was rooted in Saint Michael, the archangel, the patron saint of police officers. And so with the Orange County Shields and other organizations he was with that raised money for police officers, that bailed people out who were having financial difficulties or fighting a medical problem, that did all that. They said, can we cobble together enough money to make this statue? The statue would have a message, and the message would be that police officers are in the hands of God. As it says, the peacemakers will be the children of God, and Saint Michael would be their protector. It was hard to get the kind of money it took to make this thing. Years went on, the artists got older, the political climates ebbed and flowed. And finally, Pat got to a place in his business where he said, I'm just gonna do it. He gathered up the money from his own funds, he put it down, it's in the six figures. It wasn't an investment that didn't hurt, but it was one that would pay dividends forever. The statue lives in his driveway when it's off duty. But it's 10 feet tall, like Pat Brosnan, and it's 1,700 pounds, like me. That's the other similarity. And when Officer Ramos and Lou were assassinated in Brooklyn, the statue was brought to the station house, and it gave comfort. And when Officer Wilbert Mora and Jason Rivera were assassinated in the 32nd Precinct, at a time when people had spent the entire year before denigrating the police, criticizing the police, calling out the police, it was a point of inflection where people had to stop and ask themselves, what were we doing? What were we saying? These two officers gave their blood, gave their lives, and the community came out to the 32nd Precinct, including many of the critics. And they walked with candles, and when I arrived there, there was the statue, 1,700 pounds, 10 feet tall, and since then, it has traveled, and Pat arranges its travel and pays for it to wherever it has needed to be for fallen officers, whether it's Bristol, Connecticut, or back in the Bronx, or down in Brooklyn, giving comfort. In the statue, Saint Michael, with his sword raised, ascending towards heaven, cradles the police officer. And it is a thing that has inspired everyone who has seen it. And that's what I mean about Pat Brosnan. You know, we're, aside from our own single similarity, he's in better shape, he's got a bigger business, he's got better toys, he's more successful, he's got a bigger house, but he's got a bigger heart than anyone I have ever met who came from nothing and made it. So, welcome this year's Founders Award co-winner, Pat Brosnan. Pat, come on up.
Welcome, you. My man. Thank you, John.
Thank you. Wow. This just came for you?
Awesome. Beautifully done. Thank you. Thank you, John. I'm going to try to be brief. It's not going to be easy. But just remember, I said I would try. So, John, thanks. I don't know where to start. You know, John mentions coming into the 46th Precinct in 83 was like a hurricane. And I agree. And the fact is, I was there for the opening day of crack. Like Major League Baseball, it had an opening day. I ascribe it to the High Holy Day, St. Patrick's Day, not for any other particular reason than I'm an Irishman. I just figured, what the heck, you know? It was, could just be as likely as not. But thank you, John. So, wow, this is unbelievable. I'm honored, and thank you to the executive board for answering the call. This is an amazing organization. It really, it's beyond belief. You have to take a pause and really think about the numbers. Since 85, they have raised and distributed 170 million. 170 million. You know, it's easy to get caught up in numbers. Oh, it's 100 million, 170 million, it's a million. No, it's 170 million. That's 1,000 families. That's 7,500 per family. That's money that is every year, year after year. I recall up in the Bronx when I was running the New York Shields with my ex-partner, John Fleming, we would put together prize fights between, you know, the cops and the firefighters every so often. And we might raise 20 or 30 or 35,000 for some guy up in the Bronx or in Queens who had a child with a problem, for instance, or had some kind of an issue. And we really thought, wow, 30 grand cash. It was like, it was really unbelievable. So you talk about relativity, 170 million. It really, my mind boggles from it. So I've been deeply involved for many years in helping police families, as I mentioned earlier. With the New York State Shields, I was the founder and co-president a number of years back. And as you know, and as anybody saw the statue outside, that's been a labor of love, as John mentioned. We transport it whenever an officer's murdered in the line of duty. Not killed, murdered. Let's make it crystal clear that these are acts of violence. This is not an officer who was killed on a motorcycle, pulling someone over for a VTL. These are direct cold-blooded murders like Wilbert Morrow, Wenjin Liu, Rafael Ramos, and a host of others. And we send a statue, and it becomes a measure of solace, a measure of comfort, a grieving station for the ones that are left behind. And it's really a big deal. And it's a really big deal to me. And I gotta tell you, you know, it lives in my driveway. And every time I bring it back, we brought up to the memorial last October 12th in Bristol. I always hope and I always pray that it doesn't have to move again. But I know better. I know it'll always have to move because that's the way it is. There's a lot of violence in the world, and officers do not get anywhere near the level of respect that they should. So, as John mentioned, I'm a son of the Bronx. I'm born on the Grand Concourse to Champs-Élysées up by Yankee Stadium. I joined the NYPD in 83, and I had no illusions. I had a singular focus, and my focus was to lock up 1,000 guys. That was my goal. When I got hurt after 14 years, I had been at 843. So for all you numbers guys, I was 16% short. I never forgave myself. I always thought I could have doubled down, but I didn't know I was going to get hurt. So it's really just the way it was. So 843 was the number, and it was okay. It was a heck of a run. But I'll tell you what I learned up in the 4-6 in the South Bronx as a son of the Bronx. I learned a lot about the bad guys, but that was easy. But what I learned about was there was a lot of good guys. There was a lot of good people in the Bronx. The reason you didn't meet them or know them or see them or interact with them was because they were hidden in their apartments behind five locks. And anybody who knows what a police bar is, one of those too. So, I went into my memory file, and I recall that one of those terrific folks that I met, and I never otherwise would have met, except that she made a call, was a little old Irish lady named Mrs. O'Brien. Miss O'Brien lived up by Fordham Road on Creston Avenue, and she lived, of course, on the fifth floor. They were always on the fifth floor. So me and my partner trudge up to the fifth floor, and we're interviewing her. And basically what it was a drug building, so the dealers had control of the lobby and the entryway, and then they had guys with guns to make sure there's no ripoffs. And she would come from the A&P up on Fordham Road, and these guys made her nervous. So we come into her apartment, and I see, as I'm talking to her, and she's explaining how she's nervous from all these hooligans in the lobby, I see an old TV set and I see a photo of a patrolman, a framed photo, and I said, "Who's that?" And she said, "Well, that was my husband." I said, "Oh, really?" I said, where is, you know, he was murdered in a line of duty, her husband. And she's up there on the fifth floor, hidden behind this apartment, behind five locks. And then I knew right then and there that Mrs. O'Brien had a new best friend, because her husband had been killed in the line of duty, and now she was my best friend. So me and my partner went down, we went down into the lobby, and we grouped all the dealers together. They had all hidden the drugs and hidden the guns, and we had a little group huddle. You know, so they're listening like little kids, you know. I said, "Listen, I have a new best friend. It's Mrs. O'Brien, she's up in 5A. She's my best friend. You guys understand?" "Oh no, yeah, we get it. Yeah, because they just want business, you know, they just want to continue operating." I said, "So here's how it's gonna work, guys. Be very nice when my best friend comes into the building." So I would check in every week, maybe twice a week. I'd trudge up, see everything's good. But knuckleheads being knuckleheads, they overdid it. They tried to be so nice. They would actually go to the A&P, wrestle her bags out of her hands, and bring the bags back to her apartment up the five flights. It totally backfired. So we have an additional group huddle in the lobby. I heard them all together. I said, "Listen, you knuckleheads dropped the ball on this one." I said, "I told you she was my best friend. Now you're scaring the life out of her." So the long story short was, the whole time we were moving toward warrants, we were developing intel, we had undercovers buying into the place. So in a couple of weeks, we wound up closing up shop, locking them all up. Mrs. O'Brien, by all accounts, was still in good shape. We'd still stop in and see her. But she was a special friend, and she was a very good person that I met in the 4-6 during the days of crack, and during the time when it was really, you know, as John mentioned, it was the highest crime time, most robberies, rapes, murders, the whole deal. So you can't make this stuff up. You really can't. It's been my absolute pleasure. I'm humbled and flattered to be here tonight. I would have stayed 100 years in the police department. To me, it was the front row seat to the best show in town, hands down. So thank you, everyone. My pleasure.